Welcome everyone, my name's Sylph, and this is my attempt to beat a hardcore Nuzlocke of Pokemon Soul Silver with only Psychic-type Pokemon. The full rule set for this run is listed down below, but put simply, only the first Psychic-type encounter in each route or area can be caught. If a Pokemon faints, it must be permanently boxed. No items except health items in battle. Party Pokemon levels are limited to the next gym leader or final league member's ace, and finally, the battle mode must be put on set at all times. The Psychic-type is most definitely a popular one among Pokemon fans, but it wasn't always so. In fact, in Gen 1, Psychic was known as being so powerful that people kinda hated it. Except for Mewtwo, perhaps. Who didn't like Mewtwo, as overpowered as it may have been? In fact, the Dark and Steel types are thought to have been created in part to balance out the Psychic type a bit more. Today, we're gonna see just how powerful the Psychic type was a few generations later with the Gold and Silver remakes. Heart Gold and Soul Silver contain a plethora of fully evolved Psychic types, although the Legendaries and Mythicals will of course not be allowed to be used because of our rule set. Other than that, most things are fair game, and the encounter situations with the Nuzlocke rules are quite crazy for this one, so without any further ado, let's give this a shot. Before we leave, let's check the PC for any adventure. Excited. I love Pokemon.
I thank you, Lyra, for your contributions.
Outside the lab, there's this strange redheaded man, and I...
tell my Pokemon. I love them.
Oh, wait, I don't have any yet.
Let's fix that by picking up our starter, and I'm gonna stick with what I chose way back in 2001, Totodile, who I nicknamed Pacquiao.
Not that it matters anyway.
Before getting on with our adventure, let's say goodbye to our mom. Mom, I'm leaving on a year-long-
What's wrong? Did you forget how to get to Mr. Pokemon's house?
F*** me, this kid's never gonna make it. In Cherry Grove, we meet this absolute madman of an elder who zips around like a Reggie Ellicky. I hope I'm like this when I'm older. Although, I kinda sit in my chair all day editing these videos, so things aren't looking too hopeful. In Mr. Pokemon's house, we meet the esteemed Professor Oak, who says,
"You seem to be dependable. How would you like to help me out? You see, this son of a bitch Red, who I spent years mentoring, just ran off, never again to be seen. You wouldn't do that to me, would you, boy?"
After defeating the redhead kid in battle, we learn that his official canon name is... Passerby Boy. Man, Giovanni really hated him, didn't he? As our last pep talk, before we head out, we talk to Professor Elm, who gives us some wise words of motivation.
Why don't you take the Pokemon Gym Challenge? If you manage to defeat all the gym leaders, you'll eventually challenge the Pokemon League champion.
Or not. Wow, thanks dude, real inspiring. Lyra gives us some Pokeballs, which officially starts our run. We quickly arrive in Violet City, which is the location of our first gym. Now you would think there aren't any viable psychic encounters before the first gym, but think again. We can head south to the Ruins of Alph to find one. After completing the 4,000 IQ puzzle that no one could solve in thousands of years, we crash land into some ancient ruins and with our broken legs encounter our first Pokemon, an unknown. Now I was planning on naming it Cortana regardless, but it ends up being an unknown C anyway, which is scarily perfect.
Almost like he's psychic.
We successfully catch it, and it turns out to have a lonely nature, which is plus attack and minus defense, which isn't great. Now, when I was battling it, I noticed that we resisted its hidden power move, which is the only move that it has, which means it has to be either fire, ice, steel, or water. And this is very important. We deposit Pacquiao in the PC, meaning this little buddy is all we've got. Looks kinda cool in the overworld, not gonna lie.
Wait, where did he go?
One thing I should mention is another area of the Ruins of Alph is the only place where we can find wild Natu, so catching an unknown cuts off that encounter, but it's our only choice as the grass requires HMs that we don't have. Now, Route 32 is the perfect place to train this thing since there are Mareep here, which gives special attack EVs. Each one gives about 50 XP, and since we have somewhere around 1400 XP left before the gym, I can give it about 25 EVs. I notice our hidden power is neutral on them, which cuts out water from being a possibility. For absolute confirmation, I attack a Hoppip, and it's super effective. Oh my god, it's hidden power ice, one of the two that I wanted, the other being electric. Incredible. This also helps us immensely in the Sprout Tower against all the Bellsprouts and Hoot Hoot too, although we came super close to the level cap since I almost overdid the EVs.
Whoops.
Thankfully though, in the Violet City Gym there is a way to skip past the trainers, otherwise that would have been a forced wipe. The gym leader is Faulkner, a flying type trainer. Without HP Electric or Ice, I knew there was no way we could even conceive of getting through this battle, but now we might have a chance. He leads with a Pidgey, and we actually outspeed it and immediately one-hit KO it with HP Ice. Unreal. His last Pokemon is a Pidgeotto, which I know is quite powerful, and Tackle actually doesn't do that much on us. Hidden Power then takes him below half, he hits us with Tackle again to half, and another one is able to do the job. Amazing.
I was so convinced we'd have to do a series of resets until we got the right type, but that definitely saved some hours. Along our way to Azalea, we can pick up a great in-game item, the Shell Bell, by using Rock Smash on an HM Pokemon. The Dark Cave is quite a breeze, and we arrive in Azalea in no time, which actually holds our next encounter in the form of the Slowpoke Well. Here, we have a 5% chance to find, you guessed it, Slowpoke, which we catch and nickname Catherine. Unbelievably, Catherine ends up having a modest nature, which is pretty much perfect for us. Now, all of Catherine's friends have their tails cut off, and one is holding a letter that says, "Be good and look after the house with Grandpa and Slowpoke. Love, Dad." Man, this is upsetting. Look, even Catherine is traumatized. Because he has poison types, Proton is a breeze with psychic types, and with that, we've saved the rest of the Slowpokes from tail extinction. It's time for the second gym, the Azalea Gym, and man, I feel so at home with all these Slowpoke everywhere. We fit right in. Now, the Azalea Gym is a bug gym, which is quite scary for us, but Catherine handles them quite well since most of them don't have actual bug-type moves, and we learn Confusion at level 15 too, which helps against any other threats like Beedrill. It's time for something I'm fearing big time, Gym Leader Bugsy. If I'm honest, I have no idea how to handle him with our two Psychic-type Pokemon, but I came up with our best bet. Let's try this out. He leads with a level 17 Scyther, and I send out Catherine. Now, I was thinking that he'd just spam U-turn right away, but he goes for Focus Energy before I hit him with Yawn. With his raised critical hit chance, he could very well take us out, but he uses Leer here, so then he gets put to sleep. Whew. While he's asleep, I start using Curse to raise our defense, and we get off 5 before he wakes up, but he just uses Leer again, but Confusion does even less than I thought. Because our defense was raised though, he keeps trying to lower it, so I hit him with Yawn again. With his raised crit chance, our boosted defense doesn't really matter, and I know Confusion's not doing much, so I'm forced to switch into Cortana. Hidden Power Ice does great damage, and he would have been a 2-hit, but his Citrus Berry heals him. I just need him to stay asleep for 2 more turns. He does on the first, but unfortunately we brought him just in range of a Super Potion. I'm desperately hoping he'll stay asleep though. We bring him to just a quarter, but then he wakes up and slams us with a U-turn, which KOs Cortana without a crit even. Holy, I think that minus defense nature might have hurt us. Thankfully, from here, Catherine is able to get some curses off on the Metapod and take it out afterwards, and Scyther just went for Focus Energy, then Quick Attack for some reason so we could take it out. And finally, his Kakuna is of course weak to Psychic, so it was an easy KO. A very unfortunate loss, but I mean, we could have very well been swept with ease, so I'll take it. Now, we may have an even bigger challenge on our hand as we leave the town, Silver, who we now have to face with just a Slowpoke, and his team is scary for us. He leads with a Ghastly, which just uses Mean Look though, so one super effective Confusion does the job. He next sends out Bayleaf with high critical hit ratio Razor Leaf, but he just uses Reflect on the first turn, misses Poison Powder on the next after we yawned him, so he just falls asleep and I can get a curse off before hitting him with Confusion, then he misses another Poison Powder before a couple more Confusions take him out. Very weird move choices on his behalf, I thought we were a goner. His final Pokemon is a Zubat, which could have picked us off if we were hit by a Razor Leaf, but Bite hardly does anything before we take him down with Confusion. That AI was really weird, but I'm not complaining. In the Ilex Forest, we can pick up the Headbutt TM from this mad lad, and Catherine saves the day by leading a Kimono Girl out of the forest before we creepily follow her. The next route, Route 34, actually grants us a new encounter, thank goodness, as we can find a Drowsy here. We catch it and nickname it Tartarus, and it ends up having a rash nature, plus special attack and minus special defense, which is pretty good. Always love using underrated Pokemon like this, so I'm happy about this one. In the daycare, Lyra desperately tries to convince her grandma that we're not dating, but joke's on her. Her grandma and I are actually dating. And then we arrive in Goldenrod City. Now, I had booked it immediately to Bill's house for a new encounter, but I forgot that he actually doesn't return home until later, so we'll have to wait for that one. In the department store, I make sure to pick up a few Ultra Balls for a very particular reason. In here is also the only reliable way to get berries, as you can pay 300 Poké Dollars to take part in the drawing corner, which has some cool rewards, so I stock up quite well. I also pick up some TMs like Light Screen and Reflect, just in case we need them. In the radio tower, I was like, oh, this has been a pretty lucky run so far, let's test the lottery out. Ah, f***. I head north of Goldenrod to Route 35 to find our next encounter before the gym, an Abra. Now, as I'm sure you all know, Abra can be ridiculously tough to catch since you only have one turn before it teleports, which is why I got the Ultra Balls, and thankfully we catch it on the first one. We could have also gotten one from the game corner, but that would cut off our other encounter from Bill in Goldenrod. I named the Abra Arbiter, and it has an impish nature, plus defense, and minus special attack. Ew, pretty gross. However, it did end up having a Twisted Spoon item attached to raise the power of psychic moves, which is great as that's a 5% chance. After using switch training to grind, Arbiter quickly evolves into a Kadabra. Now this is one of the things I'd highly suggest for anyone else pursuing a hardcore Nuzlocke in these games. Make sure you have your mom save some of your money, as she'll often send you some great items such as the Colber Berries I just got, which lower the power of Dark-type moves, amazing for our team. It's time for the Goldenrod Gym. The gym is led by the normal-type gym leader Whitney, one of the most infamous trainers in the entire franchise. We're not incredibly well set up for this, but I have a bit of a plan, so let's try it out. Whitney leads with a Clefairy, and I lead with Tartarus. I hit it with Confusion for surprisingly little damage before we get hit 4 times by Double Slap. Another Confusion brings her below half before she just uses Mimic, then our next Confusion confuses her, but she breaks through with Double Slap to hit about half after the crit, then uses a Super Potion. Thankfully, we then get a crit, but she uses Metronome and gets Light Screen of all things. Oh, great. Here, I was going to stall it out by spamming Disable, but then it hits itself in Confusion. Of course, right when we don't want that. In comes her big threat, Miltank, with an increased special defense from Light Screen. It outspeeds and hits us with Attract, and I went for Disable, thinking we could get Stomp or something, but we can't even move anyway, so I guess it didn't matter. She then uses Stomp to bring us to about 8 HP before our Oranberry activates, then we make it through Infatuation, but miss Disable. Are you kidding me? I'm forced to switch now, so I go into Arbiter, who gets hit below half by Stomp, then her Light Screen goes down. It's a risky play, but I go for Disable, and we outspeed so we cancel out Stomp and she can't move. From here, knowing she'll likely try Attract, I switch into Catherine, who's the same gender, so it fails. Amazing. Knowing she's disabled and can only use Rollout now, I use Curse to raise her defense, then after the second hit I use Yawn, before getting off another Curse, and then she falls asleep, but her Lumberry activates. With our defense so high now, we survive Stomp well, and our Oranberry helps us, then I hit it with Yawn again. Stomp hits us below half and flinches us, but on the next turn we land a Confusion, and it hardly does anything at all. I land a couple more before she wakes up, and we get a crit and confuse her eventually, but she breaks through and hits us to 16 HP before I use Yawn again. Thankfully, she then hits herself in Confusion and we bring her to the red, but then she uses another Super Potion. Oh no. With this low health, I need to use Curse again to survive one or two more hits, and then she wakes up early but hits herself in Confusion before we bring her to half. She then snaps out and hits us to just 9 HP, and we flinch again. Oh. Thanks to that last curse, we then survive on 2 HP before landing a Yawn, and I have to switch here, so I send in Tartarus thinking it might just be a sack, and amazingly she went for Rollout and missed. That's kinda what I was thinking she'd do to build up the momentum from the KO, and we would have survived Rollout anyway. From here, since I need the damage, I switch into Arbiter, and thankfully she stays asleep for 2 more turns, so 2 confusions do the job. Unreal. We had some terrible luck and some great luck, so I guess it balances out. With 3 badges, we are now deemed worthy of handling the almighty Squirt Bottle. And I also find the Soothe Bell along the way through the National Park, which will be very useful later on. Cameron the photographer takes our picture with our team and pfft, what an absolute derp fest our team is. On Route 42 comes our next encounter, which we can only find by using Headbutt on the trees in the route and Execute. It took a while to find, but we catch it successfully and I decide to nickname it Dave. Now I'm sure some of you have picked up on our naming theme, but if you can get this one, I will be thoroughly impressed. Dave ends up having a sassy nature, plus special defense and minus speed, which is meh. The Miracle Seed we got earlier should also be quite handy for him. Before we get to Ekrutik, I realized we forgot to do something. Talk to the legend, Picnicker Gina, who has a chance to call us on the Pokégear and give us a Leaf Stone, so we'll keep tabs on that. After using the Squirt Bottle on Sudowoodo and having Catherine squirt... Okay, you know what? I'm not even gonna go there. We arrive in the beautiful and historic Ekrutik City. Before anything, I hit up the Pokémon Center where Bill is found, and upon meeting him, he heads back to Goldenrod, which we can go back to get a gift Eevee from him, our newest encounter. I nickname it Didact, and it has a quiet nature, plus special attack and minus speed, which is both good and bad. I make sure to give him the Soothe Bell to get it to evolve faster through friendship. Back in Ekrutik, we get the Surf HM for saving one of the Kimono Girls from the weirdo Rocket Grunt, and although we can't use it as an actual HM in the overworld, we can still teach it to a Pokemon and use it in battle, which I decide to use on Catherine for an amazing stab move, especially this early on. In the Burn Tower, we have another rival battle with Silver. His Gastly was an outspeed and one hit with Arbiter's Confusion, and the same one for his Zubat. Then, because his Bayleaf now has the special Magical Leaf move instead of Razor Leaf, it's not much of a threat and is taken down in two moves. His last Pokemon is Magnemite, which does resist our moves, but as I thought it might do, it went for Thunder Wave to paralyze us, and our Synchronize ability paralyzed it as well, so we were ultimately able to overcome it even though we got confused. Hey guys, you want to join my team?
Okay.
Now looking at Morty's team, I am not seeing any hope for us at all. Being outsped with super effective stab moves is just a terrible thing all around. We have some offensive capabilities, but defensively we're just sitting ducks against them. After thinking for a while, I realized something that might save us. A new encounter all the way on Route 43 north of Mahogany Town, which yes, you can get to even this early on in game. Here we can find none other than a Girafarig, which is part normal and part psychic. We catch it and nickname it Librarian, and she has an impish nature, plus defense, and minus special attack. Dear God, why? Good news is, we can use Girafarig against the trainers in the gym and build up some special attack EVs against them. With an immunity to the ghost type, yet super effective Psybeam against them since they're all part poison type, Girafarig is the perfect answer here, so I'm glad we could catch one beforehand. While grinding, Gina calls us and I was like, yes, we can evolve Execute for even more help, but we got absolutely jabated as she just talks some crap about her fighting a Rattata. Oof. With that, it's time for the fourth gym leader, Morty. He leads with a Gastly and I lead with a Librarian. Now Arbiter could have been a good choice here, but Gengar does outspeed it and two of his Pokemon have priority Sucker Punch. Instead, what I decide to do here is go for Agility so we outspeed his entire team besides Sucker Punch, and his Gastly just uses Mean Look, after which I can take it out with Psybeam. Haunter comes in next, and Psybeam is an instant one-hit KO on it as well because we now outspeed. His Gengar comes out next, and I was expecting it to go for Sucker Punch, but it didn't. It survives Psybeam, then puts us to sleep with Hypnosis. Yikes. It then Mean Looks us on the next turn, then hits us with Sucker Punch on the next, but I had attached a Colbert Berry to weaken its power, then we wake up and take it out with one more attack. Nice. His final Pokemon is a second Haunter, and not wanting to risk a KO or crit, I decide to Baton Pass into Arbiter to pass the speed boost and avoid Sucker Punch, but he just went for Mean Look again instead. He then hits us with Sucker Punch to just 15 HP before we can KO him with Confusion. Amazing stuff. We also get the Shadow Ball TM for winning, which might be useful. Upon arrival in Olivine City, I pick up the Good Rod, which is actually going to grant us a new encounter in a bit. Now here, I went to go retrieve the Charge Beam TM we have to surf over to, and I was going to use Repel but just said screw it, and on our way back from getting it, bam, we ran into a shiny Tentacool, which yes, I lost my mind over, but for more than the fact that it's a shiny. Those of you who watch my live streams on Twitch know that Tentacool was my first ever shiny back in Pokemon Ruby, but I didn't have any Pokeballs so I failed it, and none of my friends believed me about this differently colored Tentacool I found since we really didn't have internet back then at that age. This is the decades long reclaim, and I couldn't be happier. I name it Reclaimer, which also happens to be perfect for our Halo-based naming theme. This was destiny, there is no doubt about it. I cherish this moment by bringing Reclaimer out to stand side by side with my faded off, Lyra. After Jasmine makes us take a perilous journey up the lighthouse when she could have just unlocked the door for us the first time around, we arrive in Cyanwood City. Our next encounter can actually be found here by fishing, but it only appears at night, so we'll have to wait a bit. In the meantime, while grinding for the next gym, Tartarus evolves into a gorgeous Hypno, a Pokemon I've always wanted to use in a playthrough as it doesn't get much love, I feel. The Cyanwood gym leader is Chuck, the fighting-type trainer, and given our psychic team, I was feeling pretty confident heading into this one. He leads with a Primeape, and I send out Arbiter for the Twisted Spoon-boosted Stab Super-Effective Psybeam one-hit KO. Unreal power this thing has. In comes his second and last Pokemon, Poliwrath. Here, I use Reflect to boost our team's defense before getting hit by Body Slam, and I was kind of hoping for the Paralysis, to be honest, for Synchronize to activate. I then go for Disable, but he switched it up and used Surf, and we got brought down to just 6 HP. Holy, that was close. I'm forced to switch, so I go into Catherine, who tanks Surf well, but then we get put to sleep on the next turn. Here, I switch into Dave, as Surf does a bit more than a quarter, but then Dave gets put to sleep immediately, too. I wanted to get the Leech Seed off, but apparently that's not happening after we don't wake up, and I switch into Tartarus here as we get hit by Body Slam. Surf then brings us below half, and Psybeam brings him to just above half. His next Body Slam brings us low and paralyzes, but our next Psybeam gets a crit to take it down. Damn, for a fighting-type gym leader, that was a lot more trouble than I thought. Moving on to the Lake of Rage, I take the secret path to the house where the guy gives you the hidden power TM, which could be useful later if we need some secondary type coverage. Encountering the red Gyarados is kinda funny here since it's our second shiny in the game already. Here we can also get an amazing item, the Choice Specs, which raises the power of special moves hugely, but we can only use the first move that we choose, of course. By trading the Red Scale from the Gyarados to Mr. Pokemon, we can also get the Experience Share, which is perfect for leveling up Didax, since we can't send him into battle until he evolves. The Mahogany Team Rocket hideout was quite an easy task, with all the grunts having poison types, and we came to Ariana Grande at the end in a double battle with Lance. Now, not only was I confident from all the poison type destruction, but we've got the champion with us in a double battle. However, I realized that she had a Murkrow at the end, which has Pursuit. Lance's Dragonite also missed two thunders in a row on it, so essentially Librarian got trapped out there on the field and I couldn't switch it since it doubles the power of Pursuit, so Librarian goes down. Ouch. I was not expecting that at all. Stupid Dragonite. With that painful death past us, it's time for the Mahogany Town Gym. Ice is a neutral type against us, so we're generally able to just kind of power through the trainers, although there were a few challenging moments. Price's team is looking quite challenging for us, especially without Execute evolving yet, so I decide to pursue another evolution by heading back to Goldenrod and getting Didact a haircut, which turns out to be enough to raise its friendship high enough to evolve into a beautiful Espeon. While checking the hidden power types on our team, I found out that Didact has the rock type, so this is one of the big reasons I wanted to evolve him, as we can now use the hidden power TM on him for at least one super effective move on our team. I also teach Tartarus the light screen TM and attach the choice specs on Didact. With all the preparation I can muster, let's see how this goes. Price is of course an ice type gym leader and he leads with a Seal, as I lead with Tartarus since, weirdly enough, Seal is not an ice type. Psybeam does just less than half, as Icy Wind lowers our speed. Our Quick Claw activates though and we get our light screen up, but then Seal uses Rest. Interesting. From here I switch into Didact and Hidden Power does over half as the Seal remains asleep, so another does the job. Iloswine comes out next and I was hoping for Dewgong to be honest, so I switch into Catherine who can deal with it more effectively with Surf. Mud Bomb does bigger damage than I thought though, combined with the Hail, and our accuracy gets lowered and we miss Surf. Then get hit down to 21 HP before we land one, but its Citrus Berry heals it back to 2/3. That wasn't good at all. Here I switch into Tartarus, and thankfully it missed its Mud Bomb, and Psybeam does a good amount before we get hit by Blizzard, which Tartarus tanks well, and then we can KO it with one more attack. In comes his final Pokemon, Dewgong, and I set up Light Screen before it uses Aurora Beam, which now does little damage. It does have physical priority Ice Shard though, and Psybeam doesn't do a whole lot. We get hit down to just 29 HP on the second one, and Psybeam brings it to a quarter. I'm forced to switch though, so I go into Didact, and he uses Rest. Not good. Hidden Power actually does massive damage, down to just a sliver though. He hits us with Sleep Talk Ice Shard before using a Hyper Potion, but we can KO him in a few more attacks. Man, Didact has some power, and thank God for Hidden Power too. Before heading to the next gym, I decide to teach Tartarus the Drain Punch TM, kinda funny that he learns it, and I also attach a Cherry Berry on him. Along the way, we get the call that the Safari Zone has opened, which will allow another encounter for us, but first, the Olivine City Gym. Jasmine is a Steel-type gym leader, which is terrifying for us as it resists Psychic, but this is why I set Tartarus up the way I did. It's the only way we can get super effective damage on them. She leads with Magnemite, and Tartarus hits it hard with Drain Punch to a quarter before it uses Thunderbolt for not much damage, and our next one takes it out and gives us some recovery back. Her next Magnemite gets hit hard and brings us to full health, and then it uses Thunder Wave, but I came prepared as our Cherry Berry heals the paralysis and we can take it out with two more Drain Punches after she Hyper Potions. Solid. Her final Pokemon is an absolute monster, Steelix, and we are all out of Drain Punches, not that they do much anyway. I switch into Catherine here as she uses Sandstorm. She lowers her defense with Screech before Surf just barely doesn't take her out before her Berry activates. We then get hit hard by Iron Tail on the next turn to below half, but another Surf does the job. Drain Punch definitely came in clutch there, shout out to Hypno, who I must say is a mightily underrated Pokemon. In the Olivine restaurant, Tartarus and I observed this sailor choking on his food and... oh, he survived. The plan didn't work, Tartarus, finish him. With the Safari Zone open, we can not only get some cool items at the entrance, but we can also try and get our next encounter, which is only found in the forest biome, which thankfully is available today. After a bit of searching, we encounter none other than a Mr. Mime, which is female. Mrs. Mime, I guess. I've always been intrigued by the concept of using one of these on a team, so... oh, well, f***. Yup, that's the danger of Safari Zone encounters. We haven't had a failed encounter in a while, so that one stings. As redemption for that nonsense, I return to Cyanwood City at night, where we can use the good rod to fish up our next encounter, a Staryu, which I catch and nickname Palmer. Palmer ends up having an adamant nature, plus attack and minus special attack. absolutely disgusting, the worst possible nature. But hey, it should be quite a help once it evolves. Now, the only way we can currently get a Water Stone is by tackling, yep, you guessed it, the Pokéathlon. After meeting the owner, Magnus, who, dear lord, what was that look? If I die, you know who murdered me. We participate in the Pokéathlon and rack up some big points over time, and I also talked to the audience at one point, and this guy says that Magnus beat a Machamp in an arm wrestle. Remind me not to f*** with that guy. Thankfully, we were playing on a Wednesday, which is one of the few days that the Water Stone is available, and we can buy one to use on Palmer to evolve it into a beautiful Water Psychic Starmie. Now, in this gen, the only offensive Psychic move you can get on this thing is Psychic via TM, which we can't get until much, much later, but it still should give us some power and speed otherwise. It's time to take on Team Rocket at the Radio Tower, and hey, if you can't beat them, join them. Am I right? No, seriously, this outfit with an Espeon looks pretty badass. Along the way, Didact finally learns a better psychic move, Psybeam, and along with the choice specs, starts tearing through things like crazy, and we arrive at Petrol in no time, who, yep, Didact is able to absolutely ravage since he just has coughings and wheezings. That's for exploding and killing my Pokemon in past runs, a**hole. In the underground, we have another run-in with Silver, and despite getting confused, Tartarus was able to take down Golbat in two Psybeams, and his Haunter went down in one after hitting us hard with Shadow Ball to a third. Thankfully, we also now have a way to deal with his Sneasel, as I switch in Didact to tank the Feint attack to below half before one-hit KOing it with Hidden Power. A switch into Tartarus is then able to handle Magnemite quite efficiently with Drain Punch despite Paralysis, and his Meganium is a bulky threat, but Arbiter did well powering through with a few Psybeams. Honestly, four of his Pokemon are big threats for us, but we've found pretty good ways to counter them. After a very close call against Proton, with Palmer being left with just 3 HP while poisoned, we have to face Ariana again and, well, what can I say besides we got God again. I would have used Didact, but it was overleveled, so I took down Arbok with Starmie and Vileplume with Arbiter, and then she switched in Murkrow. Now, I used Recover so we could survive anything, and since its only super effective move is Pursuit, I assumed that she would use that, so I tried to disable it. However, she just kept not using it and using Wing Attack instead. After numerous turns of this, and knowing a crit would end us, I'm like, okay, she's not using Pursuit at all, and I have no choice, so maybe it's safe to switch. But nope, the switch triggers her finally using Pursuit, which I couldn't disable, and Arbiter gets taken down. Absolutely brutal. The final Rocket executive is Archer, who has nothing but a Houndour, Houndoom, and Koffing, so I was like, meh, I'll just send out Starmie with the Mystic Water item and Surf, and we KO Houndour instantly. His Houndoom then comes in and survives somehow in the red, hits us with Feint Attack, but we survive on just 29 HP and can KO it with another. Man, Team Rocket provided a surprising amount of trouble in this run. Well, mostly Ariana Grande. While trekking to Blackthorn City, we make our way through the Ice Cave, which is actually the location of our next encounter, a Jinx. I've always maintained that Jinx is quite underrated, so let's see about that. I catch one and nickname it Regret, quite fitting I think, and I caught it in a Dusk Ball, which should be pretty cool. On our way out, we can pick up the Never Melt Ice to boost Ice-type moves too. Nice. Upon arrival in Blackthorn City, we can check out Regret's nature in the PC, and it turns out to be neutral, which I'm fine with. Strangely enough, arriving in Blackthorn gives us access to another encounter. The Dark Cave has a secret entrance on the other side on Route 45, and only on this side can you encounter Wobbuffet. I catch one and nickname it Keys, and it has a timid nature, plus speed and minus attack. Now, Wobbuffet is quite a gimmicky Pokemon, and since we already have 6 Pokemon on our party, I think we'll keep her as backup. In preparation for the 8th gym, I got 2 Ice Beam TMs and 1 Thunderbolt TM from the game corner, which I teach to Regret and Palmer, and we also got a Leaf Stone, but the only way to get Psychic on Execute is at level 47, so I figure it's best to hold off for now. I also used the Blackthorn Move Tutor to teach Regret Lovely Kiss to put enemies to sleep. During the grind, Catherine also finally evolved into a Slowbro, and with that, it's time for the Dragon-type Blackthorn Gym, and... oh god, why? With Ice Beam and Thunderbolt, the gym trainers are a breeze, and we arrive at the final gym leader, Claire. She leads with a Gyarados, which would have been a terrifying threat, but with a Starmie with 4x super effective Thunderbolt, it... oh, it survived. Guess that's what we get with an adamant nature. Bite hits us below half before we can take it out in 2 more Thunderbolts. Not a great start. Her Dragonair then barely survives an Ice Beam and paralyzes us with Thunder Wave, and we survive Dragon Pulse in the red with 14 HP before taking it down with another. She next sends out another Dragonair, and I'm forced to switch into Regret, who tanks Slam with above half and one-hit KOs with Ice Beam. Her final Pokemon is the mascot of my channel, Kingdra. thinking she'll use Hydro Pump by switching to Catherine, and she does as we tank it really well. She then uses Dragon Pulse to bring us well below half before we get a yawn off. One more attack could KO us, so I switch into Tartarus, who tanks Dragon Pulse before her Kingdra falls asleep. I switch into Dave here to get the Leech Seed off for guaranteed damage and recovery, but she wakes up and hits us with Dragon Pulse to just 25 HP before we do. I tried to then stall her out by switching into Tartarus, but she refuses to miss Hydro Pump and hits us down to 9 HP in the red before we then miss Hypnosis. Oh, dear lord. In the end, a switch into Didact is able to finally take her down after we're brought below half by another Hydro Pump, as thankfully Psybeam does enough from about half to win us our 8th badge. Once we're approved by the Cultic Murderer Council in the Dragon's Den, that is. Back in Ekrutique, we're faced by the Kimono Girls consecutively without the ability to switch our Pokemon around, which is quite an understated challenge in these games, but thankfully with good type coverage and access to recover to heal up when able, Palmer is able to take care of all of them in a row with us having no deaths, although we certainly had some close calls, including Jolteon, who we had to pivot around for. In the Whirl Islands, we summon the almighty Lugia, who is a psychic type, so we can just grab it, right? I wish. I decide to kill it, and all the Kimono girls are very awkwardly upset with me. Fast forward to the end of Victory Road, and we have our final rival battle, and since we can prepare all the way up to the Elite Four levels, this wasn't much of a challenge, especially since he led with Sneasel this time, meaning Hypno with 4x effective Drain Punch got our momentum started, and almost single-handedly took care of his entire team, aside from Meganium, who Regret handled. Man, don't underestimate the creepy, yellow, hypnotic demon elf. With that, we arrive at the Indigo Plateau Pokemon League, and after tons of preparation getting TMs and fulfilling our AVs and whatnot, Execute finally learns Psychic right at the level cap so we can finally evolve it into a beastly Exeggutor just in time. It's time for the Elite Four. The first Elite Four member is Will, a fellow Psychic trainer, so we have to assert our dominance. He leads with a Zatu, and I lead with Regret, who, with the Never Melt Ice, is able to OKO both it and his second Zatu with Stab Super Effective Ice Beam, and, well, the same goes for his Exeggutor, too. I'm starting not to regret this choice. His own Jinx comes out next, and I know we can do more damage to it than it can do to us, but it puts us to sleep after we hit it to about half. We wake up after 3 turns and barely don't KO it, and get brought to 30 HP before he uses a Full Restore. I'm forced to switch, so I go into Palmer, but get hit by Lovely Kiss again upon switching. Jinx doesn't really have a great way to damage us though, so we're able to take it out with Surf after 3 turns, bringing us to a third. His final Pokemon is Slowbro, which is why I wanted to get Palmer out there, as now we can hit it with Thunderbolt for about 3 quarters, after which he just uses Amnesia and one more does the trick. The next Elite Four member is former gym leader Koga, the Poison-type trainer. He leads with an Ariados, as I lead with Didact with the Choice Specs, and Psybeam is an instant one-hit KO. He sends in Fortress next, and I switch into Catherine here in case this thing uses Explosion. He uses Toxic Spikes, as I use Withdraw to increase our defense, and then Surf actually gets a crit to take him down on the next turn. I'll take it. In comes Muk, which I know tends to spam Minimize, so I go for Yawn right away to prevent any more. He uses Minimize once more before falling asleep, and we of course miss our Confusion. From there, I switch back into Didact, and Psybeam is a one-hit KO on it. In comes Crobat, which does outspeed and hits us hard with Wing Attack, but Psybeam takes it out as well. We are quite low on health and poison, but his last Pokemon is a Venomoth, which we outspeed, so one more Psybeam finishes him off. The third league member is Bruno, the Fighting-type trainer, and we all knew how this was gonna go, right? I send out Dave and set up Reflect right away, after which I can one-hit KO every single one of his Pokemon with Psychic, taking minimal damage from Blaze Kick with Reflect up, and since I had attached an Akaberry to lower the power of Fire-type moves. In the end, we took less than half damage. Sorry Bruno, this is not the run for you. The last Elite Four member is Karen, definitely the scariest one for us with her Dark-type team. She leads with an Umbreon that is notorious for stalling, so I lead with Dave to try and get the Leech Seed off for guaranteed damage. It takes 6 tries to do so because of Double Team and Confuse Ray, but we eventually get it off. God, this thing is so annoying. I then set up Reflect to lower his Feint attack power before eventually switching into Palmer so we can actually get some damage off, but we get hit by Confuse Ray in the process and then hurt ourselves before getting hit. The Leech Seed does help though, and in conjunction with Recover, we can just stall it out, but she uses the Full Restore. After a total of nearly 5 minutes on this one Pokemon so far, I switch into Tartarus and get hit by Confuse Ray again, and we hit ourselves in Confusion before getting hit by Payback. We then get hit in Confusion again, but Leech Seed is still helping. With Drain Punch Recovery and Shell Bell and Leech Seed, I thought we'd be fine, but between misses and Confusion hits, we get absolutely rocked when I thought we were nowhere in range and Tartarus goes down. At least this now gives us a chance for a free switch as I send in Catherine, who finishes him off with Surf. Man, oh man. She next sends out Vileplume, and I switch into Didact, who gets paralyzed upon switch-in, but I'm fine with that as Synchronize pulls through. Psybeam is then an instant one-hit KO. In comes Gengar next, and with Paralysis, we'll no longer outspeed, so I switch into Palmer as she just went for Spite, and now we can outspeed with Surf, which does over half, and she just went for Focus Blast afterwards, so one more Surf does the job. Murkrow then comes out next, and thankfully Ice Beam is a one-hit KO on it as well, as we've had more than enough of Murkrow in this run, I'd say. Her final Pokemon is Houndoom, and my calcs tell me Surf is a one-hit KO, so I go for it, but it barely survives in the red, and I'm like, what? And then it KOs Palmer with a Dark Pulse. Thankfully, Catherine can then come in, survive a Dark Pulse just barely, doesn't get flinched, and can take her down with Surf. Oh. I checked after the battle, and it turns out I had the wrong item on Palmer, the Metronome instead of the Mystic Water. Ouch. That was a rough battle, and Starmie was gonna be my answer to Lance, could have swept him in fact. It's time for the champion, and I am terrified with my plan torn to shreds and only 4 Pokemon left. I use the remaining rare candies we have and hope for the best. He leads with a Gyarados and I lead with Dave. He goes for super effective Ice Fang, but I attached a Yachi Berry to Dave so he tanks it quite well. I then go for Reflect and he starts going for Dragon Pulse instead. Our first Stun Spore misses though and we get hit below half and then we miss another one. We then get hit to 58 HP before finally landing it and now that we outspeed I use Leech Seed and he stays paralyzed. Reflect goes down but I can set it up immediately again and start stalling Gyarados down, taking him down with Psychic with 80 HP remaining. In comes Charizard next and I switch into Catherine here who gets hit by Air Slash on the switch. He hits us again to below half but we land a Surf which is a one-hit KO. Amazing. In comes one of his Dragonites next, and I thought he'd go for Thunder, but he actually went for a Dragon Rush instead and missed, after which we hit a Yawn, and then he misses another as we go for Withdraw, and then he goes to sleep. This allows me to pivot into Regret here and use Ice Beam, which is an instant 4x effective KO. In comes one of the scariest threats of all, Aerodactyl, which does outspeed us and uses super effective Stab Rock Slide, but I had put a Chardy Berry on Regret just for this reason, and we live on 19 HP and can take it down with Ice Beam. Unreal. From here, Regret is able to sweep his remaining 2 Dragonites as well, officially winning us the champion battle. I cannot believe we pulled that off. But this isn't the end. We may have conquered the league, but an even stronger trainer awaits. After being entered in the Hall of Fame, we can set off to the Kanto region for post-game adventures. It is here that I add Keys, the Wobbuffet, back to our team, and we also have an opportunity for one last psychic encounter using none other than the Pokéwalker. Using it, we're offered a special event location called the Winner's Path where we can find a Beldum after 8,000 steps, a beastly final addition to the team. We successfully catch one and nickname it the Chief, and after a ton of grinding, it eventually evolves into a Metang, and then at level 45, it evolves into a monstrous Metagross. The gym leaders in the Kanto region are relatively manageable now that we have a fully EV-trained team and access to great TMs and items, and Metagross was a great help for most of them too. We're here for one specific reason though, which I wanted to include as a bonus in this video for you guys. Notably, in Saffron, we did finally get to pick up the Psychic TM, which I was wanting all game. Right outside of Mount Silver, we get our final team picture from Cameron. This is one for the memory books. In Mount Silver, we can also pick up a fantastic item, the Expert Bell, which I attached to the Chief. With that, we arrive at the peak to gaze upon none other than the strongest trainer in the land, Red himself. There is no need for words. It's time to do battle. Red, of course, leads with his signature level 88 Pikachu, and I lead with Chief. With the Light Ball attached, he outspeeds and hits us hard with Thunderbolt to below half before we can then respond with a super effective Expert Belt boosted Earthquake for the KO as the hail continues to hit us. Red sends out Charizard next, and I switch into Catherine to tank the Flare Blitz as Leftovers helps us with the hail. He then uses Air Slash on us, and we don't flinch thankfully, so Surf is then able to KO him. Venusaur is sent in next, so I'm forced to switch into Dave, who gets hit by Sleep Powder on the switch. Knowing I cannot take Sludge Bombs, I decide to switch back into Chief, who is immune, and that prediction helps us to then smash that thing with Zen Headbutt for the one-hit KO. Blastoise comes out next, and I decide to switch back into Dave, who tanks the incoming Focus Blast really well. Now, I thought we were within range to survive a Blizzard and maybe respond with Giga Drain, but it seems that we weren't as Dave gets absolutely rocked, but that was the only place he would have really been useful anyway, so it was worth an attempt. I send in Didact here for the Choice Spec Psychic, but it just barely doesn't KO, but Blizzard doesn't do a whole lot, and Blastoise goes down to the hail. In comes Snorlax next, and I decide to just hit it as hard as I can with Psychic, and it gets to right about half before Crunch then KOs us immediately. Rest in peace, Didact. From here, I send Chief back out to smash Snorlax with a Brick Break KO. Red's final Pokemon is Lapras, and at this point, the Chief has put in some amazing work, and we could use the damage, so I go for one more Brick Break, which does about two-thirds before Brine takes us out. Partially because I thought it was the best option, and partially because you guys haven't seen her in action yet, I send out Keys to absorb a Blizzard and return damage with Mirako to finish Lapras off. And with that, we've beaten the strongest trainer in both Kanto and Johto, the legendary Red, with three Pokemon remaining. What a journey that was. Honestly, this run was filled with some really surprising moments, but overall, I really enjoyed working with the psychic types that it had to offer. If you enjoyed the run, please don't forget to hit that subscribe button, as it really helps a lot and grows our community. A huge thanks to my YouTube members and patrons who make these videos possible. If you'd like to support and get your name up here, the links are also down below. If you enjoy, drop a like down below to help the video out, and leave a comment letting me know what kind of run we should do next, and I'll see you guys for our next challenge video.